open the meeting of the September 23rd, 2015 Conservation Commission meeting. And first item on the list is RDA 2015-15 239 to 243 Main Street. Curtis. He's here. Am I reading the wrong agenda?
Yes.
God's sakes.
That's all right. Nobody pays attention.
Everybody's looking at me like. I grabbed the wrong pile, didn't I?
That's all right. Here, take mine. Take mine. Fine.
No, I got it here.
I'll look on Rebecca.
All right. 7 o'clock, RDA, 2015-16, Oak Street, right-of-way, Boston Gas. That's why you look at me funny. No, that would be me.
So I'm Amanda Neville with Conoco Environmental, which is subcontractors for the Boston Gas Company in this case. They are looking to place a gas main on Oak Street between 15 and 75 Oak Street. And around number 65, there is a culvert that runs under the street. To the best of my knowledge, the current gas main runs over it, and they will continue that trend with the new one. So because of that, we are put into the 100-foot buffer zone in that area. All of this work is within the roadway right-of-way. You guys have seen this many times before. They'll saw cut the road. They will use a mini backhoe to dig out any of the dirt. Typically, they just side cast it to the edge of the trench. And then once they put in clean sand and lay the new gas main in, they'll reuse as much soil as possible. Anything that they can't use, they take off site at the end of each day. It's about a 2,000 linear foot project, so it will definitely take a couple of weeks to complete. But they will repave, and any sections that they work in each day, they will repave up to a point, and then they'll just metal plate it so they can come back the next day. And you know, when you walked in and you started talking about utility work in Reading, I was like, oh, they're gonna love me.
They're replacing all the gas mains in Reading this year.
Right, eventually.
And water and sewer and.
Good. A couple questions. Are you, as in the other projects, are you bending the existing line in place?
Yes.
You are, okay.
Yes.
And.
In general, that's usually how it's done,
right,
is that correct?
Yeah, because it would require more work and more disturbance to take
right.
out those old steel lines, so they usually
right.
will just abandon those in place and then run the other gas line right alongside
right.
it if they can,
mm-hmm.
Or wherever is going to be easiest, depending on the other utilities in the roadway.
Okay, but over that culvert, though. Do you think that's still going to work, or do you know?
As far as I know, yes. I mean, until they get out there and they really start seeing where all of the utilities are, if there's enough depth of cover, which there should be, they'll just go right over the top. I haven't heard anything contrary to that. Certainly, if they decide that they need to go under it, that would require an entirely new scope of work, and you know, they'd essentially just start the project over again because there's a lot more involved, obviously, in that.
And the other question, MWRA is putting a water main right down Oak Street, starting next, probably April. Are you in coordination with them on that?
I wouldn't be the one to do that, so I have no idea if somebody from National Grid would have spoken to somebody maybe when they were applying for like their street opening permits and things like that. Typically, those types of things will be communicated. Sometimes they're not.
Chuck, we've already issued the MWRA permit.
Mm-hmm. We did, and knowing that they're both working on the same street, we provided George St. Boris with a packet and an agenda so he knows about this. So he. Probably be making sure that there's coordination on that since they give the street opening permit downstairs in engineering.
And you want to do that this calendar year, this project?
If they can, I mean, they're really bogged down with a lot of gas projects, so there definitely is the possibility that they will not get to the replacement this year. it's always hard to tell because I've had times where they say, okay, yep, we're definitely thinking about doing this in October, and then other jobs run longer and they say, okay, now we have to put this off till spring. If I would bet on it, I would say they would wait till spring unless they really need this line replaced this year, just because I know they have so many other projects going on that a lot of my projects are backlogged at the moment, so.
It would make sense. Gas should go in last because it's on top. So it makes sense to coordinate with the MWRA project as well.
Sure, yeah.
They wouldn't want to work around a new gas line, especially if it's in the way of what they need to do.
Because
they are relocating some drain lines as part of that project as well to get that water main in there. So it makes sense. And it sounds like the backlog is
also.
Yeah, and I mean, I can certainly pass that along to the project manager for this and say, hey, you got to get in touch with, you know, whomever to coordinate this. My guess is they probably know about it, but.
Yeah, you can't be sure.
Yeah, I really don't know.
I mean, plus they're going to be dewatering, and if they dewatering under your new gas line, that
right.
Could be a
so yeah, so it makes perfect sense. So I'll definitely pass it along just in case, you know, they are not aware. But I don't think it's an emergency to replace this gas line at the moment. So.
And if they had to, they had to, but, you know.
Right, right.
Right.
It sounds like there's plenty of other things they can be doing.
Right.
Well, if they were going to wait for this,
yeah.
So it's not going to be standing around, so.
Is it within our jurisdiction to require receipt of acknowledgement to MWRA that this project is going forward?
Not unless we could link it somehow to resource area impacts.
Right. Okay, I guess we have to rely on our internal coordination between you and.
Do you have the engineer contact information that you could give to her for that? Was it FST that did it?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes,
so.
FST. Yeah.
Yeah.
So we could do that. I'll actually put that on the.
Yeah, that would be perfect.
Yes. Under BMP details, are you proposing both of these? Or?
So we will put silt sacks in all of the catch basins.
Okay.
And then, you know, we are prepared to dewater as necessary because we are going over that culvert. We never really know. Based on what I saw out there, I mean, it's. You can barely see the culvert because there's a fence on one side of where it is, and then it's personal property, and it looked to me like the culvert didn't come out from below the ground till about 20 feet into the property. So if there is potential for runoff, we'll certainly put straw wattles or something across that one area. But the majority of that area, you can't even see the stream. So, you know, this is our typical. Even just in construction, putting the silt sacks in as, you know, as they're working. But there's not too much else required at this point unless, again, they do run into water or they do have to go under the culvert. But my understanding is this should be a straight shot. It should be pretty simple.
Mr. Chair? Just a quick question. Is the drain pictured on the BMP for the silt sack? Is that the only type of drainage structures that are out there? Or are there any curbside cutouts?
So I'm actually not positive. The ones that I see most often are those ones that it's, you know, literally just that sack. They put the catch basin cover over it to catch anything.
Right.
And then they just empty it as necessary. Those are the only ones that I've seen. It doesn't mean that those are the only ones out there, but.
No, what I mean is in the road, in the roadway, in terms of what type of drainage structures. I don't know if that was covered in the site visit or not. Okay. And I couldn't make the site visit. I'm sorry.
You
couldn't. maybe we could put something in. you know, in the requirements that, you know, if another BMP is more suitable to the drainage structure in the road, that BMP be used.
Sure.
You know, not necessarily sticking, you know, something that's flexible.
Yep, yes, that makes sense.
Allows, maximizes protection.
Yep.
It's a quick operation. They're doing it on Summer Street. I go to work that way. You know, it's always paved when I come home. The roadway is swept pretty well. And then there's plates in the road where they stop.
They should clean it up to the best of their ability at the end of each day.
It's pretty good. They've done a good job, depending on which contractor they're going to use. This particular contractor does a good job.
Otherwise, I don't have any other questions.
Okay. Any other questions or comments from the commission? Anyone from the public have any comments or questions? I'll entertain a motion for a negative determination of applicability.
So moved.
Second.
Second.
All those in favor? Okay.
On a related topic, Chuck, if you could not only notify the FST, but actual person in MWRA, we find a better responsiveness directly from MWRA, that'd be good. I don't know if it was Mary White or who it was.
But I have a list of people. She was the environmental.
Okay, you're all set.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
See you again next time.
Yeah. They're replacing all of them. I'll probably be hanging out here a lot, so.
So I have that prepared except for the addition of notifying FST with phone numbers, the BMPs, and the MWRA. So if you'd like to sign it, it's ready.
All right. It being 7:20, do we have a number on that notice of intent yet?
I did not. This is yours, Jack. Is there a number on that?
I didn't check today.
Okay.
We'll do that right now if you want.
I think we have a couple minutes.
Yeah, I know. I know that's 7:20, but that gets a little early.
I never know which clock to go by in this place.
Pick one.
All right.
Whatever you say. You say. That's what time it is.
Oh, yeah. You want to do the certificate of compliance for 23 Pond U?
We're not doing 99.
We are, but we have a little bit of time. Yeah.
You went to Pond U, right?
We did.
Yeah.
So we did a site visit, and it was pretty stable. I couldn't tell there was any construction there, as far as I was concerned, other than the compost filter tube log. Pretty stable. And a few weeds here and there. So.
0649.
What is it, 0649?
Yeah.
And you have that paperwork checked for the certificate of compliance?
I do.
The report said that the deck, I think, was a little bit larger than planned. Was it large, significantly?
You know,
it didn't infringe on the resource area.
No, it was within, you know, the house was here and the deck was like here along the back line of the house. So it kind of, if I'm remembering correctly, I mean, if you made it any smaller, it wouldn't make any difference, I don't think, so.
Yeah, we observed a new concrete pad next to the house, and then in Hayes, this was the Hayes report.
Mm-hmm.
They said that they had put something on the existing concrete, like a drill hole. We saw that.
On the wall, yeah.
On the wall.
Yeah.
But he said that they didn't put the bounds, but the bounds were there.
Oh, I read it to mean that they didn't put in a separate post. They just put the marker in that drill hole in the pad.
They did not. They put the bounds right in the grassed area. There were three of them.
Oh, okay.
And he had said that they weren't putting them there, and the owner asked if he could remove them, remember?
Well, the owner had asked. He was under the understanding that they weren't, somebody was under the understanding, I don't know if it was him or us, or that they didn't need to go there.
We didn't think they were
going
to be there.
Yeah, we weren't expecting them to be there.
Yeah,
they were
there.
Right. So he asked, you know, well, if I don't have to have them here, can I take them out? So
I think he does have to have them.
Well, so they were in the order of conditions?
Presumably.
They were on the plan, yes, and they're there.
Yeah.
They're flush with the ground.
So it's a variation that wasn't actually a variation. So they should just stay.
Well, I mean, right, right. I think.
I'm pretty sure we were blind.
I think it's a crazy idea to put them and stick them in the grass myself. That's just my 2 cents, but that's okay.
I don't think they serve any purpose where they are. Who would know what they are? They don't have the blue sign on top.
Oh, yeah. They don't?
No.
No.
No. It's like,
the one in, there is one right at the 25, no disturbance, right at the edge,
which
past that concrete, and that has a sticker on it, and but the other three don't.
They look like just a regular stone bond, like a surveyor's bond. They don't have.
But you should have the stickers on them.
I don't know how that sticker's going to stay on there with people walking around and mowing it.
Yeah.
It's in the yard. Kids are playing there.
It seems we may want to revisit that at a later date. How we want to deal with that in the lawn thing.
Well, yeah. What does the order of conditions say, Chuck? Do you know?
The plan has it there.
It does. It says to be set on the plan.
If I can find my plan, I'll show you.
So the order of conditions was only October of last year.
Right, so.
That shows right on this plan.
Yeah.
It says to be set, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, that's what they said. So I think they have to stay.
I mean, I don't think they're a hindrance to him because they're not serving their purpose. Nobody knows what the hell they are.
So we should revisit that, not for this particular project, but what we need to do for our policy for that, because I agree, it's kind of, you know.
Well, I think usually the order of conditions says you will set bounds either at an interval or at turn points, and they'll have those stickers on.
It does. Yeah.
Usually it says that, because then always the question, will you provide the stickers, which we do.
So if the case is that there were no stickers on these bounds, perhaps we shouldn't approve this certificate of compliance until the order of conditions is met.
Assuming we were put them in the order of conditions.
So what exactly are you wondering if it says anything about using that drill hole?
No, what does it say about the requirement to set
mark? It just says shall be set at least 2 feet into the ground at turning points and otherwise 40 feet intervals along the 25-foot offset.
Does that have to be labeled?
It doesn't. Yeah,
oh,
it doesn't
exactly.
Say anything like that. No, it doesn't say anything
right.
Like that.
And
all right.
Doesn't say anything about a height. I mean, usually we say 6 or 8 inches out of the ground, don't you?
Some we've said 6 or 8 inches.
Yeah.
Others
I've had
we've said
before
flush.
Where they've said.
It depends on where it
a
is.
A minimum
in the yard.
Out of the ground. Yeah, this is right in the middle of the lawn area.
Right.
Yeah.
I mean, in those situations, we've agreed to flush.
Flush.
So they can just
so that they
mow
can
right
mow
over
it.
Right.
Yeah.
Without much trouble.
Just says 2 feet into the ground.
Right.
Yeah. No, it doesn't say anything about labels. You want that on it? I hand those out a lot.
Right.
Yeah, I think future order conditions we should on case by case basis say how much, if any, it should be above the ground and require the label.
I'll just put
said just a of granite or concrete post, who knows what it means.
What should we start with, above the ground, 8 inches, 10?
Well, on a case-by-case basis, depending on yard topography.
I mean, I think this is a good example of when you want them flush. It's right in the middle of the yard.
I think it's okay that they're flush, but they're...
Well, I just want to set up a boilerplate so you guys know to change it or they request it. We have, so I could put in there as something, because then we'd have to remember to change it each time or write it in each time.
So outside of lawn areas, it should be 6 to 8 inches, I would think.
So I'll write 6 to 8 inches, and then labeled.
You could even put inside a lawn area, flush with the lawn is fine. Flush with the ground is fine. You can write it that way.
And those don't have to be labeled, because that'll come right off with the lawn.
Probably, yeah.
All right, we'll do something like that.
In general, there should not be lawn on the downgraded side of those markers. But sometimes it's after the fact.
And that's the thing.
Or if it's grandfathered in.
Yeah, it's pre-existing. You can't have the guy.
Okay. So we all set.
So for this, they're in. They should stay in. Part of the order conditions.
Yes.
Yeah, absolutely.
I'll make a motion to approve the certificate of compliance as is.
I'll second.
All those in favor? Okay.
Now it's simple.
Yes.
Now it's prepared, and you can sign away.
Being 7:20 or later, up next is Notice of Intent 270-0649, 99 Fairchild Drive. And how do you pronounce the name? Is it Lou?
Yes.
Lou.
Thank you.
Let me... I have to read my script. It's not as intense. The public hearing for 99 Fairchild Drive, Lou, DEP number 270649, is now opened and being conducted concurrently under the authority of the Massachusetts Wetland Protection Act, Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 131, Section 40, as amended, and the Reading General Bylaws, Section 5.7. An attendance sheet is being circulated for all those present to sign. The attendance sheet is at the door. If you haven't signed it, please do so. At this time, would the members of the Conservation Commission please introduce themselves, starting with Chuck?
Chuck Taroni, Conservation Administrator.
Michael Flynn.
Anika Scanlon.
Brian Sullivan, Chair.
Al Coulliard.
Jamie Maughan.
Rebecca Longley, Vice Chair.
Julie Roger, Recording Secretary.
Okay. It's all yours.
Yep. For the record, my name is Jack Sullivan. I'm owner of the Sullivan Engineering Group. I'm here with the owner, Algie, of 99 Fairchild Drive, and Nancy Toomey, who is the architect of this project, is here as well. Basically, what we're here to do tonight is there's an existing deck on the rear of this house that looks to be original to the house. The house was constructed in 1992. And what they'd like to do is remove the deck and construct a new 12 by 14 sun porch within the same footprint as that deck. There'd be a proposed sun porch, there'd be a platform off of that porch as well. The existing deck is 21.7 feet from the wetland line. I had Norse Environmental out in March of 2015. They delineated the wetlands. We would not be getting any closer to the wetland than the existing deck. Presently, the existing deck has is existing sonotubes. When I originally submitted this application to Chuck, I had a note on the plan that those sonotubes would be removed by hand. No machinery in the backyard since we're so close to the wetlands. But in talking with the contractors who came out to the site, they have a good point. Those sonotubes presently don't meet code, and we have to put in Bigfoot sonotubes. And they have to dig down 4 feet. And then with the Bigfoots, they have to open them up. And to try to get the old sonotubes out by hand, they'd be way too heavy. You can't do it. And realistically, they can't do it by hand. And anyone who went to bid the job just said, we're not doing it by hand.
You mean you can't install the new ones by hand?
No, because we're going to have them hand dig. But to get the Bigfoots opened enough, and you have to go down 4 feet in depth, and to get the old sonotubes out, you'd have to try to break them out, pull them out. So what I tried to do, I tried to be sensitive to the area still. I'm showing, you know, a limit of work line, which would be straw wattles, as close to the deck as possible. I put a note that the contract is to put plywood down and come in with the smallest machine possible to remove the existing sonotubes and for the excavation for the new Bigfoot footings. Obviously, the majority of the existing decks within the 35-foot no structure zone, a portion of the existing decks within the 25-foot no disturb zone. As such, we need a variance from the commission to work within the 35 and basically to work within the 25, even though we're not really getting any closer than the existing condition. I did put together a variance request document that was submitted to the commission and highlighted why we feel a variance should be granted. Two forms of mitigation that the owner is proposing is plantings. We're showing 5 low bush blueberry to be planted towards the existing tree line. And we're also proposing a drip trench off two sides of the new sunroom area. So any water that falls off the roof would go into this 18-inch wide by 18-inch.
How is that roof sloped? If you have drip trenches on two sides.
I showed it on both sides. I wasn't sure. This was something I did. We had put in a plan without the drip trench and mitigation. Then I talked to my client. I said, we were going to come for discussion to talk about forms that you might like to see. And I said, I think they're probably going to want to see plantings and some sort of drainage. Nancy, do you know how the roofs?
I do, yeah. If you wanted to see a quick elevation, this is the roof.
This is the addition.
This is the addition off the back. So it's just a gable roof.
Oh, so you have a peaked roof on the addition.
That's correct. Yeah, just a gabled roof towards the back.
Well, but the front is toward the wetland.
Mm-hmm. Correct.
Yeah.
So there shouldn't be any drainage off the front. You don't only have drainage the two sides.
Off the two sides.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So I showed it off. I had put it on the front and one of the sides. There's an existing wood platform that leads down to their pool area on one side. You could put some crushed stone under that platform, but there's that platform staying in place, so there's not really room to put a drip trench on that side.
I'd feel better if... So where's the drainage from that side going to go? It'll just drop on that wood platform?
There'll be a wood platform. It's an open, it's like a deck. It would go through that open platform. There's a 5 by 14 proposed platform. I mean, we could condition it that underneath that platform it should be crushed on.
Do you want a gutter right there?
I thought of doing a gutter as well, and I thought of doing some sort of dry well, but my concern is with where the wetland line is and the height, I wouldn't get, by the time you put a dry well in place, it'd be no, I'd be right at the water table. I wouldn't really have much relief. So I thought a low maintenance solution would be the drip trench.
We're only talking 40 square feet on each side of that roof. A dry well would be this big.
Yeah, I know.
But the trench, I like the trench, but I hope we can avoid the trench on the wetland side because that just puts us another foot closer to the resource area. But there shouldn't be any drainage off that front.
I don't see a need for the trench on
So that existing wood platform is staying.
That's staying.
But this red line seems to overlap it. What is it just?
Because it's elevated.
Okay.
It's an elevated. All right. That's a lower, that wood platform, I should have said lower. It's an at-grade platform. So from the existing deck, there's steps that lead down to that lower platform, so it'll remain in place. And I should note, there'll be no grading changes associated with this project, and they're not removing any trees.
Can I ask a question? How many Bigfoots is it going to require, do you know?
Right now, if you look, you have the drawings there, if you look.
Yeah, it looks like 9.
Yeah, part of the problem that we're showing is that if there's a cantilever at the kitchen that's coming out 2 feet.
Yeah.
Currently there's no support under that cantilever. It's picking up a second floor. So we need to put 2, but that fortunately is back behind the 35-foot build zone. I'm suggesting that we need 2 at the front and then we need 2 in the middle. It's a 16-foot span. I'm just trying to cover my bases. It may be that we can make that span work just fine, but the joists are going to be running side to side. So I'm assuming we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 big footings. And then where the platform is, we have the two at the deck. And that will then span back, if that's just a solo deck.
So you want to run your floor joists at the 12-foot side to side instead of the 14-foot?
Yes.
Would it be, I don't know if it would be more advantageous to run it at the 14, but pull your big foots in 2 feet and use an LVL under there. That way I think you may be able to just get two big foots to span that 12 feet and then two up against the house, you go down to 4.
That could be. I think part of the issue that we're facing is that we want a raised ceiling in the new room, and the way the gable's running, we'll need some kind of ridge beam up there. So that's got to come down at the end wall. If we cantilever out, we're going to run into some issues with trying to support that. So I'd rather up front say this is what we're planning to do. If we can pull it back, believe me, we will. But I think at this point, given the ridge beam, given the way that that elevation is going to be, bringing that support straight down is the safest way to do it. Otherwise, we need another one in the middle to pick up the cantilever as it comes down.
Not necessarily. It depends on the design. If you put out the right size, if you went to a structural engineer and you had a LVL sized, then you could probably go with, you know, 2, 3, 9, or 11 LVLs, and you could probably, I think you could distribute that weight. That roof's fairly small.
It is a fairly small space.
Yeah, so I think with the right engineering and lumber, you could probably get away with going that 12 feet, and you can hold those big foots in probably a foot on each end, so you'd probably be 10 feet, 2 in. I mean, that'd be the least.
That's a possibility. Yeah.
It's not designed. This is just preliminary plan.
This is preliminary. It's not been to the structural engineer. We're just making sure we can do this as a viable project, and clearly we'll do the best we can to try and minimize the Bigfoots and minimize their location. But as a worst case scenario, I thought it was best to show you what could happen.
Yeah, I get it. Just if it worked out the other way, you know, you'd be 2 feet.
Yeah,
further, you pick up a couple feet, so I mean, a couple feet's a couple feet where you're so close.
Which would be easier for the contractor to so.
I don't know, now he's underneath there, father, so. That's a real mini machine going in there, if there's a machine going in there.
I have a question. There's a, also included with this, an extension to the bulkhead?
Yes.
Ooh. Yes, so the 2 foot of the main house on the second floor extends out a little bit further. What we're proposing is that we also extend the first floor out that 2 feet. Use then a portion of the bulkhead foundation to support that on that end. But because of that, the existing bulkhead, you can't get in because the bulkhead now is recessed 2 feet, so you just can't get the headroom. It's a finished basement. You need to have an egress out of that finished basement. It's already finished. So in order to make it all work and we get that man door out of the basement for egress, we need to extend the bulkhead out another 2 feet. My thought is on that. It's probably concrete block going in beyond where they are right now with a new set of stairs that go down. And it's just a standard bulkhead cover. So
is the existing bulkhead poured concrete?
It's poured concrete cover.
And you're just going to put blocks on the other end of that.
Exactly, to continue to break open the opening and continue that over. I use part of that bulkhead to support the new extension for the kitchen. That's the intent.
And it's not accessible now?
It is, but if it's only, if the way to envision is that the second floor has an extension of 2 feet with the roof coming over. We want to also extend the first floor like it does on the other side.
Yeah,
so as soon as
I
you extend
you.
That first floor over, yeah.
I get you. Yeah.
Kill the headroom.
Yeah, I get you.
Question. Why did you pick low bush blueberries and not high bush?
I could have gone either way.
Yes.
Well, I think
you like high bush better. I'm
well,
fine with that.
It's closer.
I was debating and I spoke with them.
It's closer to the wetland, and the high bush is more of a wetland plant, and I think they'll thrive there.
Okay.
The low bush would too, but it's just that I thought it would be. I didn't know if it had something to do with you wanted a low.
No. No, I just had to pick one and I just went off.
That would be my preference.
Next time we'll ask why high.
Hope not. So a question about construction access. I see there are some small trees to the south of the house, between the house and the south property line. Do you anticipate, I mean, I'm guessing the span between those, the 8-inch and the 3-inch, is maybe 10 feet. Do you anticipate any tree damage getting equipment in and around?
I'm not anticipating like a backhoe or excavator coming back there. I'm picturing a Kubota. Like it's very narrow. It might be 4 or 5 feet wide. It's almost like a glorified bobcat.
Okay.
Going through something that, with an arm that they can lift the old footings out of place and get them out of there. But something small with a small digging arm that they can get in and out, but nothing like a backhoe or an excavator.
Did you also say that you're going to put some plywood down?
Yes. I want to protect the lawn. And
yeah.
I mean, it should be, that work should take place rather quickly, but it'll just protect the lawn. There'll be no rutting of the lawn. There'll be no potential, you know, tire picking up, erosion concerns. So I've done it on other projects in sensitive areas. It seems to work pretty well.
Whether it's 6 or 9 new footings, you're going to have excess material. You're going to take that off site?
Yes.
Any further questions from the commission? Any questions from the public?
Chuck. Make it quick for me, I'm sorry.
Yep.
I heard that this is not a finalized plan, and it always makes me a little nervous to give a an approval to a non-finalized plan, because it seems to me that I heard that you're going to use the bulkhead as part of a footing. I'm not really sure that's going to fly.
The existing bulkhead is a poured part of the foundation, probably.
So
that's the part that we would use as
that?
Support. Yeah. The rest, it would be the concrete block as it extends.
And it's going through structural structural
review,
engineer?
Right. It is. Structural engineer Dan Webb in town will be taking a look at this. I think this is representative of the worst case. I'm hoping that we can eliminate some of those Bigfoots and kind of condense this, but you know, obviously, if we're anything other than what we're showing, that's going to be an issue. I would imagine we'd want to review. But if it's less than that, I would imagine that would be a good thing.
I also see that I just envision that platform that's at grade, and with the rain dripping on that platform and bouncing up against the new house, gutter's going to go in there at some point, and maybe some sort of infiltration can be worked into this plan at that point. I don't know how far away it is, but it must, you know, the overhang can't be real far. Do you understand what I'm saying?
This is up, yeah, this is
seems
up.
Like you're going to put a gutter there.
This is up above the ground about 6 feet, so I don't know. You're thinking splashing against the foundation.
Is there access right there? Do you walk out of the house there?
No, the only access out is where the bulkhead is, to the left. There's windows underneath. You can see the windows from the basement, actually. The basement plan on page 4. Do you have that set? Here, but you did not show this.
Sure, keep in mind that roof on that side is only 6x7. That's not much more than a portico over a front entrance room.
Well,
so there's gutter already right here. It's not 12x14?
The whole thing is 12x14, but there's a peak in the middle, so what's draining onto that wood platform is only 6x7.
Are there gutters above? Or are there any gutters above that?
There's gutters on your upper roof, yeah.
Gutters here. Nothing. That goes on to this platform. Yeah, great.
Okay.
Well, that was my comment. It's just the plan isn't final. There's no stockpile area shown on the plan. You answered the question about the bulkhead. There's no construction access on the plan. And need to change the high bush to a low bush to high bush. It would be nice to have a final plan. So that's all the comments I had about this.
I think the reason why there's not a final plan is that you know, they want to make sure they're, or they want to have an idea that the board is going to be okay with granting the variance before they go ahead and do the plans. Can we give them an idea that, you know, it looks like it'd be okay? We can't tell you for sure. We can't take a vote, but it looks like it's going to be okay. Go get your final plans and come back.
That's up to the board, but it seems reasonable.
Oh, we could approve it.
Could approve the size and say anything outside of this would require another coming to meetings again. Come for us again.
Yeah, but that doesn't get us a final plan.
It does.
Well, we could require,
we have to require
final
the final plan
prior to construction.
Yeah, that's fine. Let's do that.
Well, requiring the final plan, if it's different from this, I don't see what that gets you.
Well, it would be within the, it would be this much or less disturbing. It's kind of a judgment call, but.
Well, I mean, in the final plan, I mean, the plan before us right now doesn't show footings. The final plan would only be the structural plans that we'd be getting. So.
Well, you'd want a plan that shows the footings.
Right. So we do want it, but I guess what I'm saying is the plan that was given to us with the application shows the footprint of the structure.
And that's not going to change.
And that's my point.
Yeah, that would be a plan change. That would be a.
And then we could require the footing plan once it's designed.
I mean, we could even approve it with a contingent of no more than 8 or 9 footings or however many. And if they come in less, all the better.
9 big foots is a lot of big foots.
It's a lot.
It's a lot of soil.
It's a lot of big foots.
And you, Chuck, are recommending that they show the stockpile area and the construction access?
It's usually on plans, mm-hmm. Stockpile area, construction access, the note saying what's going to happen with certain things and how many Bigfoots there are and all that there. I mean, I understand the process and approving a box and then you build within the box, but I guess now that Al's on the commission, I'm just going to wait for his response, but structural engineering, if you need to make a change somehow, you're going to change your whole project to accommodate that structural change. So there could be some variance where things shifts one way or the other.
No. Is there some sort of, are we on any time guidelines? Is there a sense of urgency here for this? Or do we have when's the next meeting?
I just want to make sure, like you said, there'd be some degree of comfort before she goes and spends more money.
I think, but you can tell by the conversation on the board it's going in the right direction. I think we're okay with the 21 feet and all of that stuff, but I think Chuck and probably a lot of other board members want to see a more detailed plan, the big foots and a couple more notes on the plan, and in all likelihood, probably be okay. So do you want to table it? You want to
withdraw? Is it okay
withdraw?
If we continue it? I don't know.
Continue?
The schedule.
Well, I can run it by him quickly. When's the next hearing?
2 weeks. Is it 2 weeks?
Okay, why don't we request a continuance and we'll see what Dan Webb's schedule's like and try to at least square away the number of footings and locations.
It sounds like just little tweaks, yeah, little problems,
stuff.
It's going to be fine.
So for over 2 weeks or what?
It's 3 weeks.
3 weeks.
The next meeting's in 3 weeks.
14.
And the only other thing I'd want to say is usually I do show a soil stockpile area. In this case, let's say it ends up 6 holes, 4 feet deep, 2 feet wide. The material's going right off site. I'm not coming in with big stockpiles.
Just put that note on the plan.
Okay.
Excess material will be removed.
And I'll show an access route.
No stockpile.
There's only one way to get in. You can't get out of the pool.
Yeah.
I'll show some arrows for access, and I'll change the bush to high bush.
Yeah.
Jack, the machinery going in there, surround water is not going to work.
Okay.
So if you could, do mulch sod, that would be fine. Or you can do hay bales.
I don't know if
we don't use the straw wattles.
No straw wattles.
Machinery going back in there. Yeah. Okay.
Not for this project, anyway.
John, back. Are those schematics ours?
Yes, you may have those. Those are.
Okay. I'll take a coffee and whoever else wants that.
But you like those mulch socks that are like...
Well, the mulch socks are pretty substantial.
They're
I mean,
like
you don't need a lot
inches.
Of it, but maybe...
Okay.
What was the reason why you're not going with the foundation?
Foundation underneath it? It's
just a frost wall.
Because it's expensive.
Yeah.
And
so
it blocks, and it blocks the windows from the basement. And we assumed it was easier to construct it with the sonotubes from a conservation standpoint.
That's less
because it leaves it open, it's less excavating and less disturbance. So that's really the primary reason.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
Just as a comment, in my opinion, I think this is a project that does, in fact, require notice of intent, but I think it's at the lower end of the project. If we were 25 feet or 35 feet in instead of 21 feet, I think RDA would be fine. So I think we've kind of defined the minimum for a notice of intent here.
And with the stipulation that we're really replacing a structure with another structure.
Right. Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
A new construction, that wouldn't apply, but since we're within the existing footprint.
It's pre-existing, you got to learn.
Right.
Yep. Okay.
So what just happened there?
Do
is
we
that,
continue?
So should I follow through with that, or do you want to actually take what you just said and say it again when we're not in the middle of a notice of intent so everyone can kind of like dissect it and digest it and have their comment? Are we just going to move forward with that? I'm okay with it. I'm just wondering if it kind of happened when we were talking about something else.
We'll talk about it in a minute.
Okay.
So you've asked for a continuance.
Yes.
You have your continuance to the next meeting, and we'll look for the new plans.
All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thanks.
I move we continue the hearing for
99
Fairchild
until
the 14th of October.
Gosh, yep.
I will second.
All those in favor?
It's a long way away.
Okay. We have to close the hearing as well, no?
No, we don't.
No, we don't close
because we're continuing.
Leave it open.
We've asked for additional information.
Right.
That's right.
Let's wait and see what we get.
That was the close.
And I won't be at the next meeting.
Nor will I.
Okay.
I'll be in Tuscany, sorry.
Oh, boy.
I'm so sorry.
Hey, why don't you go to D.C. and I'll go to
so as long as everybody else is going to be here, we'll have a quorum.
Should be.
I'll be here.
Okay, great.
Will you be around?
No, I'm in D.C.
Oh.
Yeah, we have a quorum. All right, it being 7:30 or later, invasive removal discussion, 60 Willow Street, Rendon. And he said he was not going to be here tonight, but we did make a site visit, and we were discussing... a clarification on the ownership, but based on what I saw at the site visit, he's doing a great job.
Is 60 Willow the one closest to the trail?
Yes.
It is. To the tracks.
He got the permit to build that garage a number of years ago.
He did talk about that.
Yeah.
So we had a question about town land, non-town land, conservation land. What is the status of the land that he's working on?
It's town land. It is.
It's a sign there.
Reading.
There's a sign at the entrance that says it's conservation land. And we need to replace that sign, by the way. Did you notice how bad that was? You can hardly read
Chuck's
it.
Chuck's going to tell us it's not conservation land.
Oh. Doesn't that sign say conservation land? I think it does.
I didn't see it, but I guess it's changed.
It used to be conservation when they thought the Abajona was perennial, but it's intermittent on that side.
That's right.
So there's no 200-foot riverfront area.
There was in the 200-foot riverfront area, but then it got
originally
delineated as an intermittent stream.
But I think that the town owns that land.
Yes.
Right.
Town
land, but not conservation.
It's not Conservation Commission land?
So no.
What's our jurisdiction?
Saying, why are we here?
Because he's working within the 100-foot buffer zone.
What does that sign say? I thought it said conservation land.
Probably
right
did.
There at the entrance.
That's conservation land, Mallet Soames.
I thought it said Mallet Conservation Land right at the entrance to that trail. See that dash line? That's
over there?
That trail?
That's a semi-maintained trail.
Yeah, paved.
And I thought that sign said.
So maybe that lot right there isn't, but the next one over is the conservation land.
No, it's all owned by the town. The reason why we're involved is because he's doing the work. We were called by the police to go down there, and so I went down there. He was within the buffer zone to the resource area doing this work, so I started to talk to him. And if the first step is that we approve the work within our buffer zone and he goes to the town, he asks him if he can continue with this work,
I
then
see.
That's fine. We're just
I
dealing
see.
With our portion.
I see. Well, he's done that whole backside there. He's done an amazing job. Really nice through there now.
He removed these vines on the trees on his property originally, and then he started getting into the Japanese knotweed, and what he does is he mows it down, but then he takes the root systems and he digs those out and he completely dries them out.
Out on the paved path there.
And some of the vines that he's been removing are poison ivy.
Massive poison ivy stalks. Massive.
Put it in my hand and I said,
yeah, that's poison ivy.
And that worked out.
Yeah.
Oh, good.
All right, so this guy seemed to me during the site visit to be under the impression that if he got approval from the Conservation Commission that was enough for him to just go do that work. So I was just a little concerned of that someone's going to come back to the Conservation Commission and say, you know, why did you tell this guy that he can do work on town land?
I don't know
if this board has the authority to say
we can
work on
town
work land.
On conservation land. We do that.
And we can approve work in the buffer zone.
Doesn't
well.
The town have to come and?
Not necessarily. I mean, like up at Bear Meadow, we approved that those guys cut down those fallen trees.
But that's conservation land.
That's conservation.
Yeah, that's
land.
This isn't conservation. This is town land.
Well, conservation land is town land. But what department in town has authority
well,
over
that
land?
Well, that's the question.
That's the question.
That was,
do we know, Chuck?
It's. No, we don't know. I mean, I think that he would just go to the selectmen with our, you know, and get some
endorsement.
Approval. Yeah, with our endorsement. And it's unlikely that they're going to say not do it because I'm going to phrase the letter that this stuff will start taking over. He's doing a good thing, and if the town wants to go in and ever use that land for anything, this stuff should be cleaned out and get a good Samaritan here, you know, taking an active role in keeping that land open.
He did say that he wanted to take some of the smaller trees on his property and start revegetating the area where he has eradicated.
He wanted to move them from his
knotweed.
House down closer to the knotweed.
Yeah.
Which I don't think we'd care about that either, but
benefit to that or?
Well, it's actually yeah. I mean, you're creating some more natural habitat. I mean, the Japanese knotweed. Is invasive.
Oh, I thought you were going to say something like he's taking the trees from the up and dry and moving them down next to the wetlands so they'll die. So.
Actually, that whole area, he said, had trees that were killed by the vines.
Yeah.
The vining, we don't know what kind of vines they were, probably poison ivy, but, and then the Japanese knotweed. So there were several trees over there that he had said have died because of the vines. The vines choked them. So essentially, be putting back what was there.
Yeah, it's all owned by the town.
So the commission's in favor of this, but
we can't tell them to go ahead.
Are we overstepping our bounds by saying?
We tell them to go ahead. We're telling him that we think it's okay, but we're not the final word on whether he can work out there or not.
long as he's clear.
He's not removing trees that he shouldn't be removing, I guess, because that was the concern in the letter. And so if...
He's not removing trees.
Trees.
He's taking trees on his property, the little ones, and starting to repopulate the area that he's taken the knotweed out.
He's removing invasive species and planning on moving trees into the area.
Right, native.
Are they native trees that he's moving?
So...
I didn't see any Norway maples specifically.
There were none. Oh, up on his property.
Yeah, I was getting dark too, so.
I thought
So this isn't an application. It doesn't require a vote by the board. Am I right on that?
We're gonna approve. I'm hoping you guys approve the work and say something like you believe that it's okay that you. Continues on, so I can put in a letter and take the letter to the selectmen or whoever else is in charge of this type of plan.
Is it within 100 feet of a resource area?
Yes, it is.
That's what Chuck is saying.
Here's the resource areas here. I hope they'll show up. So that made the map or the path disappear, but let's see if this new thing will work.
Doesn't look like to me it's within 100 feet.
Well, here's the path. Everybody won't remember walking on the path?
Yep. Yeah, we were down. It was
right.
Japanese always on the other side of that path.
Yeah, I think it stopped back here, but
where is he working? It's working right behind his property?
Yeah.
No, on the other side of
the path.
Yeah.
He has this all open. He's working all over here. There's even a path through this area here that he's working on.
There's actually trails from the neighbor riding the four-wheelers.
Well, this guy also tells them not to do that, and it's really not that ripped up, but there are some marks. So, as an ex-motorcycle rider, I know that if you're out there a lot, it's going to be pretty messed up.
I'm glad he's doing this, but why is he doing it?
He's just bored.
Yeah.
You know what? I asked the same question, and I found out he was an engineer, and I just stopped asking more questions.
Simple enough, I guess.
I just figured it's something they get into.
He's
getting more time than he needed on his hands.
He's doing a good job. I mean,
yes.
Really.
Yeah.
So I think that as I would feel comfortable to have Chuck write the letter and circulate the letter and approve it at the next meeting. Why don't you compose the letter, Chuck, get it to us, and then we'll approve it at the next meeting. So we all get to see it before it goes out. Does that sound right?
I can just send it around.
Can you just email it to it, and if we have comments?
Yeah, that's fine.
I usually sign these letters, because we don't, the chair usually signs some, but usually I sign some of them. So I can circulate the letter. You guys make your changes to it. I get what you're saying.
The only thing that my own
says,
we're not giving information.
Okay with us, but
you need
the okay from somebody else.
Get the approval of the owner of the property.
Yeah, something like that.
I would suggest that in this process that you, Chuck, find out what town department has control over that land.
So if it's
I'm gonna give him. I don't think
selectmen.
He asked me to help him out
town,
here.
I think so.
He needs that at least, and where to go to from that point.
I just think it's fantastic that somebody is actually aggressively helping out their abutting town land.
Yeah. No, and I think.
I mean, how many scenes have we seen that
where they dump stuff?
Where they've dumped and
dumped
stuff and
cut
dumped
out mature
and
trees
because
it casts a shade on their vegetable garden.
I think.
Which is also.
I think this
property.
Is really.
He's been doing it a while too.
That's no insignificant effort.
It's huge.
And it's repetitive,
huge.
Too.
I agree, and we should encourage Chuck to write the letter in a manner so if when he does go to the selectmen, they get the idea that we're completely on board with this.
Someone want to make a motion to that effect?
Is there a motion?
I don't think there's one needed, is there? He's going to type the letter, circulate it around, and we'll make a motion at the next meeting and approve the letter. Is that what you're going to do, or you want us to approve it?
Approve the work with the stipulation he gets permission from the owners to continue, and I'll write the letter
and
circulate it, and then I'll sign it and send it off.
I think it would also be good if he's doing any plantings that they do you know, that they are native. You know, I think that would really capitalize best on the effort he's been
Probably cover ourselves by saying in the letter that the letter approves the removal of invasives, but does not approve the planting of any species. So if he does want to plant anything, he's got to let us know so we can see what it is.
I think that makes sense.
Chuck, did you have something up there before that showed
make it easy for him.
Two different
doing all this work.
Yellow line parcels?
Give him another hoop to jump
not discourage.
Discourage him from keeping on going?
Yeah.
How difficult that would be. Chuck's in communication with them, let them know that, you know, just tell us what it is, we're going to approve it.
I just think if he's interested in planting.
Well, he's taking stuff from his yard.
That would be helpful before whatever seeds have fallen into the soil from the invasives. I mean, I'm glad he's taking out the roots and all that.
Oh, you should see what he's got all the roots lined up on the asphalt, drying them out. It's unbelievable.
But the best bittersweet leaves a whole pile of seed pods in the soil.
Yeah.
You know, and given a chance, if nothing else is grown there,
yeah, so that's
you'll get the bittersweet coming back in.
Yeah,
in the next
season.
I'm
fine. You want to turn them loose? Turn them loose.
Talent.
That's fine.
You know, whatever starts coming in is something that's acclimatized to that area.
Right.
He was ripping out the vines, though. There were three different types of vines that he had taken off
sure
of his trees.
I'm sure bittersweet was one of them.
Bittersweet was probably one of them.
Oh, and a porcelain berry was the other. The grape looking big leaves.
Yeah.
And poison ivy.
And poison ivy.
Good for him. I think that's great.
It's a wetland indicator, just like schools are in Reading.
Big shopping carts.
All right, so I'll entertain a motion that we send a letter to Mr. Rendoni.
You could CC the Board of Selectmen.
And CC the Board of Selectmen. Chuck will write the letter. I'll entertain a motion. Does someone want to make a motion?
I'll make a motion to send the letter, and provided that he gets approval from the neighboring town.
I'll second.
All those in favor? Okay. So scheduled item for 7:40, we are going to, we made a site visit. This 115 Forest Street, the owner can't be here. He had a very serious family issue.
Request a continuance?
I think he did not request. He spoke to Chuck before the meeting, and he was had a very difficult time even talking to Chuck. So he didn't request a continuance. However, based on our site visit, I think it makes sense, if you agree, I think it makes sense that we probably want him to convey to us what he wants to do. I mean, because he was kind of...
All over the board.
All over the board. So,
Are you talking about Forest Street?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Do you think, based on our site visit, do you think it makes sense to wait till he's here?
Yeah.
Yes, I think he needs to hear from us. We gave him an indication that he was trying to put a picket fence right next to the wetland, and then one point asked if he
in the wetland
extend it.
He was yes.
Extend it further into the wetland, and we said, "Well, that's probably we can't speak."
He was in the 25, the wetland.
So we said, you know, we can't speak for the Conservation Commission, but we don't think that that would fly. I kind of think we need to give some of these people an idea of where we would be going.
Where we're
going to
stand.
Yeah.
But I think I'd rather he was here.
Yeah.
So I move we continue this to the 14th.
Second? Is there a second?
I'll second.
All those in favor? Okay.
Chuck, do you know if he was okay with us continuing? Or...
I think under the circumstances, that's all we could do. He didn't talk to me too long. I didn't get a chance to ask him any questions. So I was really left.
It's the least of his concerns at this point, actually. So
it's continue or deny. So
yeah,
I'm sure he'd rather have continue.
Yeah, so. I think considering his circumstances, it's the least of his worries at this point. So
yeah.
Okay. Do you have your minor projects ready to go or?
Is there one more on the agenda? Was this the revised?
750.
What is this?
Is a 750 on the agenda. There was an agenda that was emailed out that didn't go into your packet. So that had an additional item. It had an additional item.
That's the one I don't have.
Okay. Yes, it is.
Bethune, right?
Yeah.
Bethune. 11 Bethune.
Okay.
11
That's right. I remember.
Mr. Kahlo, 11 Bethune. I am going to, because I built Mr. Kahlo's house, I'm going to recuse myself.
Okay.
And I'm going to go on that side.
Did we get any handouts from this?
No, this is...
This is just...
We got a letter from George.
A memo from George.
Why did I not get that? Anyway, my packet must...
I emailed the letter out.
You did?
At 6:30 or so.
Today?
So where'd you get that?
This is...
From George.
Is this Forest? This is not Forest.
Is
it the same thing? No. Cool.
I got these.
Is Forest Acres the same thing?
Yes.
Yes.
All right.
Okay.
So we got this.
He's in this way.
Yes, right.
Okay.
So Ed Carlo approached me. He said he would like to make some changes on this piece of property. He's sitting in the back right there, and he provided some pictures to help them. He is going to file a request for determination of applicability, but he's asking you also if that's appropriate for what he has in mind, and he'll go over that, and what you'd like to see as part of that submittal package.
This is that large detention basin as part of that development.
This is that one that has the large detention. I don't know if that's shared or not, but
that's it.
Yeah, and we've had some discussion with that in the past, correct? Haven't
just,
we?
Just
this?
Updating.
This area.
So the detention basin is right here.
But when there's some mowing or something in there?
Drainage comes here. Then there's a weird.
George visited the property yesterday. He was telling that they're responsible for the maintenance of it. I maintain it right now. It is on my property just for the mowing of it. The issue that I was discussing with George is that on the detention pond, although it does function.
There you go.
The issue is that, and that's the picture I've taken today, I sent some other pictures to George prior when we had the rainstorms. As you can see, the rock pile there is at the end of the mouth of the drain, and it comes in. And it's substantially lower than the other end. So it's settled. Obviously, we've had the snowstorms, a lot of the weather. It has crushed it down. Yeah, it has dropped it down. So when we do have weather, it'll stay for a lot longer period of time than the basin is meant to be used for. So my questions to George was, A, how can we fix this and include conservation, because we're working close to the 100-foot range. The discussion with Wee is to wait till it rains again, but even after it rains this time, because it's so dry, you may not get a good reading. So we're gonna kind of play it by ear, and it's not a big rush for this to be facilitated, but I just wanted to get it on to the RDA and find out what the committee wants me to go forward doing. In a way to be fixed, and what I discussed with George was, it's just to add a little bit of loom in those areas to raise it back up to the original height lines for the detention pond.
So the issue is that there's some relatively small isolated areas within the footprint
here?
Of the basin.
Yep. That never really, it takes a couple weeks for it to finally drain. So from our storms this winter, I didn't get this portion here and over here to here didn't drain till the middle of July. So I had wetlands, like it was just wet right here. Now where I should have taken a better picture for you is where the drain came out, and where the original pictures that we have is those, the rock basin there was inside the mouth of the drain. That's how high the level was. Now, again, I should have took a better picture with you with tape measure, which you'll see in other photos, is that it's dropped down 17 inches. So obviously it's settling here and not draining for a longer period of time. So we're trying to raise the loom and add the right loom, whatever it's grade 8 or whatever the loom is, to make sure it drains properly. But it's just pockets inside the detention area. So that his we were both on the same idea. It's just that he wants to see it in person, which I agree with. And unfortunately, the last times I called him to come out, he couldn't make it, and on the times we had those storms, so he could see it. So I snapped some pictures and showed him. But he still wants to see it for himself, but he did agree. We had the surveyor come out, and he did say there was some depth drop, a few inches. And that's in the letter that I think George had sent this afternoon. So it's kind of just a work in progress. He wants to just wait till it rains again to tell me what we really can do. I wouldn't bring heavy machinery back there. I actually, the construction company that we're dealing with, the landscape construction company, will drop soil and will wheelbarrow it in, not to disturb. There's really, we're not that close to the 25-foot or the 35-foot line. We're not even that close at all. More than
what's the issue with water standing in those depressed areas?
Mosquito hatching. It's an area where it's a part of our yard, so it's a place where, when we sold the property, we were under the impression that this was going to be a dry basin, and that's what we're talked about. So it would facilitate out. It's a storm drain. We get it. We want the water to be clean and move back to conservation land, but it's puddling for such a long period of time. You know, you're having issues with mosquito, lava, etc. So we just want to raise it back up to the original levels that it was at.
Now, Chuck, correct me if I'm wrong. I don't think even an RDA is necessary for this work. It's a stormwater BMP.
But under our bylaw, so we're always dealing with bylaw too. But you're right.
Is this maintenance?
It's a stormwater BMP, and I consider this maintenance if they're bringing it to the original plan.
I mean, it's almost like working inside a tub.
I just wanted to bring it up so we weren't doing anything outside the realm.
Although it doesn't drain like a tub.
No, unfortunately it doesn't.
Well, we need to make sure we're not decreasing the detention volume in that basin.
Mm-hmm. But if
that's the critical point.
If
it was designed to be certain grades,
yeah.
Then it's
you
not...
You could replicate that grade.
Yeah.
That's what we're looking to do.
Yeah.
So just bring it up to the grade that was existing when we moved into the property and when it was built.
So you think some settling happened also?
Again, you've been to the site. I'm hoping that at some point on the other project that we're going to talk about, that you'll come to a first site visit prior to the next meeting.
Mm-hmm.
That we can walk through and I can actually show you. You'll see the depths.
This is definitely the ponding end. I've been here before when there was water.
Yep.
In this whole area here.
Put some loom in there once.
I think it was wet that week. Yeah. But
that
when you took out the rocking, they never
put it back there.
They didn't put anything back in.
I thought we did some maintenance once already.
Well, your maintenance was taking out the rocks because you said I could leave the rocks, so I could not leave the rocks. Because we had rocks to block that, like a left turn here. Sorry, I keep missing the button. So we had rocks that went like this, around this, when the building was being done. And then we had rocks going across here. So we took out the crushed stone here and the crushed stone here.
Those were temporary.
Temporary fixes. But as you can see, and it kind of is a good picture, it goes uphill towards the detention to where it's supposed to alleviate back into the conservation. It's an uphill climb. And you can, you know, when you stand in it, you'll be able to see plain sight, but they did survey it and they did say it was lower. So I think it's just something that it may not be under the RDA or notice of intent, but I think it's just something that on the site visit, when we talk about the retaining wall, I definitely want you guys to just give it a look at. It can be done manually. Again, no heavy machinery going in, but it's definitely something that, you know, we want to fix and bring back up, that would say to code, I guess.
Did you see what the shots that George took or not?
I did not see the shots that George did not take. It was the surveyor gentleman, Charlie. I did not see those shots, but they had told me, and some of the gentlemen in engineering had told me, yes, it was below what it is expected to be at, and they didn't, you know, and I asked them that question, do I have to go to conservation, but, you know, we discussed that we should, because I'm surrounded by conservation, so I want to make sure we're giving back and not taking out, you know, I'm definitely for making it a better area and giving back to the conservation group if I can.
So it sounds like right now that George is still involved, so to say that it's still going to work and function properly, I think right now George is kind of looking at that. If he says he doesn't see any problems with this, then Mr. Carlo needs to come in with his own engineer and make sure those grades are, I mean, I guess you have a plan, and you can get the grades, and you can bring it up to the grades, because we've already approved
Yeah, it's definitely
such.
Below the grades you've already approved.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Mm-hmm.
I wonder why that water doesn't infiltrate.
Remember, it's there's a very shallow, high groundwater right through this. That was what Tom's point was during the whole meeting.
George had also mentioned to me about a different process that could have been done with having it built up higher and something in the middle. I kind of lost him on that. I'm not an engineer.
Yeah, George was saying what he does is he puts his stones in the center, and that's where his drains are. Yeah.
So it travels all the way down.
That crushed stone area.
Yeah.
Is
there another picture?
There is another picture, but I don't know if it has that.
I'm trying to remember. That's the drain, right?
The
yeah, that's.
That's where the outflow comes out.
Why not just take that low area and decrease so that it drains into that discharge area over the stone?
That's not a discharge area. That's where it's discharging from the stormwater from the street coming in.
So it's the inflow.
The outflow is down. It's down near these flags here.
So it's coming from
the invisible fence.
Storm
oh,
into
okay.
It,
all right. So.
And it's a big
okay.
picture. In. And then out over
here.
There's a V notch.
Does water stand in that area of crushed stone?
Right in here and all around, as you can kind of see the difference, but all into here and all here, it stays for a considerable amount.
But I mean in that area of
yes.
crushed stone,
yes,
the water
sir.
Sits in there too.
Yes,
but
sir.
You're not going to be changing that, correct?
No. Nope, that'll still be where it'll come out. But again, when I talked to George, if that whole area is low, a couple inches, we won't move the rocks, but we'll have to add more rocks to elevated. You know what I'm saying? So that whole area where the rocks are itself too has sunken. And again, by my tape measure, 17 inches. I know that's not the exact science, but like I said, it's something that you have to kind of see. And in that picture, I apologize, does not do justice. The other pictures that I have it just full with water, so it's not a good telltale sign either. I mean, because that was right after some storms.
You think that this discharge point right here is 17 inches lower than it was before?
Absolutely.
The actual pipe is sunk 17
no,
inches?
No. The pipe is up here. The ground below it where we have the those rocks when he built it, the rocks were in the mouth of that pipe. So we took some pictures when we first moved in, oh, we got a new house. And then as we watched it, I brought the tape measure out and took the picture, and it was 17 inches down to that rock. So if I push rocks up, it could be 15 inches, 12 inches, whatever you want it to be, but it's dramatically sunken down that area.
So it's this area that actually is lower now.
Yes, ma'am.
And
right
then,
here?
Yeah, and it was always supposed to be flat.
Well, it's supposed to have somewhat of a pitch going towards the wall. On the plans, then that's how it was explained to me.
Okay.
Because it's going to drain towards
drain
to the wall.
To the
green
notch.
Yep.
But yeah, if it was never compacted, you could get...
I think it's just my unprofessional opinion is the settling issue where just, you know, the soil settled. Again, I'm not an engineer.
Approximately how many square feet of area are you going to be adding loan?
With some material underneath. Literally, it was like a lot of still being
anywhere from 50 to 100 square feet, I would say.
And how big is the space?
Not very big.
Yeah,
I would
no,
say
right,
much
yeah.
bigger than that.
Well, you think it's bigger than that?
Oh, yeah.
The way we're being
into that.
I don't think yeah, right, maybe it's a little bit of
it's not acting.
Well, I'm not thinking of the other side either, so
but still for this
300 inches
is
300 square feet. And how big
crazy.
Space is
crazy, yeah.
I don't have that number off.
1,000?
It's 1,000, about 1,000.
So from here across,
I mean it does seem funny that there was no
is
sort of trench.
We don't have an issue. Green, beautiful grass. It's here where we have all the water problems down this end. Again, I don't know if it's an issue for this committee, but I wanted to bring it up because you will be coming out at some point, I'm hoping, for a site visit for the retaining wall. And I wanted to make sure it was on the docket, so we discussed it. And that's, again, George came out yesterday, even though it's been bone dry, he wanted to see it again. And he agreed that there is some, you know, some, as we say, shrinkage or
settlement.
Yes.
What retaining wall?
Sorry?
What retaining wall?
That's, I'm here for a discussion about an RDA for a retaining wall in the front part of the property.
Ah, okay.
Unrelated to this. Yeah, unrelated.
Yeah,
same
unrelated
property,
to this.
Different
same property.
Yeah.
Two different things.
So what we're hearing is work inside this detention basin doesn't need a permit, and maybe a minor project permit.
Well, it's inside 100 feet.
You can see one of your posts here. Here's your post.
It would
mark
the minor project.
But it is maintenance of the
basin. But it's a BMP.
I think it's unclear if we allow that.
As far as the bylaws,
that doesn't really meet the bylaw.
But we do have a vested interest in making sure the detention basin still functions as designed.
Mm-hmm. And it sounds like the engineering department's got that under control.
Yep. And again, just not to interrupt, but it does work. It's just in this area, it's like we've had some of those heavy rainstorms where this basin is filled to the brim. And it's absolutely full to the brim. So we'll take a picture, that's great.
Really?
And then all the way to the top. And then, hours later, it's all 90% is dissipated, but this area here has stayed, and it's stayed for weeks.
Hours? It only takes hours for it to drain?
For the main thing, it took maybe 6 hours and it was drained out. But again, we had when we had that major rain, right here was all full of about 6 inches of water, so that portion didn't drain. But all this drained right out like it was supposed to. There's a little hole in the wall over here, it was bubbling out, it was doing its thing. But it just stayed on this end. So
the water's not supposed to sit in there.
No. Right. But like I said, if you stand in it, you're looking uphill. And it's not really hard to.
It's that the purpose of that is to slow the flow of the water. So there's four underneath that V notch. The V notch is probably about 8 inches from the ground, and then below that at ground level, there's four weep holes in that wall. So it's supposed to have a couple inches of, in a regular event, in a normal event, supposed to have a couple of inches of water in there and then go out of there, and then that notch is supposed to slow it down in a major event, and they did it 30 or 50 years
ago. Was the certificate of compliance
the
already
last
issued
event
for this?
Was pretty big. It was
pretty
a
sure.
train event.
Yes. It was big, yeah.
Yeah, we had 3.5 inches.
Yeah, so, that's not typical.
That's probably 5 years old.
3.5? Just over the 2 year.
There's a V notch right there.
Mm-hmm. And you can see right the hole right there.
Oh, yeah.
I can send, if it's okay with you guys, I can send some pictures with showing the water in there.
Sure.
In the drain pipe, I can send it to Chuck and he can distribute to the team.
Sure.
To the committee.
You can forward them to us.
Yep.
Yeah. Okay.
And then you'll have a little bit of a better idea.
So we'll wait till George goes out and there's a,
yeah,
there's a better plan.
Yeah,
and
a couple rainstorms actually. Once then.
Not going to be in the next 10 days, I can tell you that.
No, I know. It's funny, I kept getting on him. It's like, I kept coming every rainstorm, and I said, now it's been a drought. So it is what it is. It's like I said, I'm not in a super rush for it. I just want it to be, with the season coming in the winter, obviously we're probably not going to have that many issues with that. But then again, if we get a lot of snow, or regardless of rain, we will have those issues come the spring. So I'm, trying to get ahead of the curve here and get it ready to go by that time so we can, properly fix it. Again, not trying to add anything to it. I want to go back to the level that was compliant.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm hearing no permit from the commission on this, as long as we're bringing it to the plan.
Not work within the footprint of that detention basin.
I didn't hear that.
Not work within the footprint of the BMP. And like I said, it sounds like George is on board with that.
Okay, so that's number one.
Okay.
Here's the second half.
Yeah, that's probably not the best picture to start with, but that's just, I'm giving you an idea of how far away from the 25-foot line.
Do you want me to get to a different picture so you can explain it?
If you could, some of the ones showing, okay, can you go keep going? That the orange line is me taking the picture after to give you a proposal of where the wall may end. Again, there's no hard plan. This is a question for you guys to tell me what you want me to do, whether it's a request for a determination or a notice of intent. Here is the driveway. Now, the fence here, curving in, we have a lot of erosion off of here. We were asking for a retaining wall to go at least to here prior. It went to here and we've stopped. Now we have the erosion, the fence coming in. To me, it's an erosion problem, number one, but also it's a safety issue.
That's off your driveway. That's not off the
roadway.
No, this is the driveway. The roadway's out here near the hockey net. Here's the circle. You come down here, this is the driveway.
Okay.
It's 90 feet driveway. So my questions to the committee are, again, we have erosion problems. You can flip to a couple of the pictures without the, that's the wall. This is some of the reasons why
We want to put that wall in. As you can see, the walkway has already dissipated down because there's no security to hold it in. So, you know, for a year and a half, 2-year-old house, we shouldn't have issues like that on a walkway.
You're getting the issue on the existing retaining wall already, too?
It's already fallen down because
it's not deep enough.
It wasn't a retaining wall. It was a piece to be put in place at the time. That's what it was. So we're looking to have a retaining wall run to, you know, from here down, this angle. Again, looking for footage, I know that my orange line, I put the tape measure, is around 45 inches on some points and then 55 inches on other points, which is within the 35 foot range. I understand that that's what, you know, I have the questions on.
Yeah,
so this first tape, yeah, okay, so.
Is that where you want the retaining wall?
It's gonna be more like in here. So that's she made a bad little move here, but it should be a little bit closer to where the flatter part of it is. So that 54 inches could be closer to the 10 foot buffer. But again, I'll have hard plans. I'll have what type of wall will be built.
10 feet from the resource area?
No, he's 10 feet from
the 35 feet total, correct? So 10 feet from the post that you guys had placed in.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm saying, so from the 35 feet, the ones that you're gonna see in this picture I marked off, which again will change because it'll probably be more like the wall would go here, so that may add a foot or two. But we're looking at, you know, from the 35 foot line, we're looking to get a variance of 5 feet on a couple of the posts and 6 feet on one of the posts. So here's an example. So I'd probably move the wall more in towards here, so we may be closer to the 10 foot barrier, but we want it to wrap here so we are protecting this land. Because again, it was out to here, this section of rock, those posts were in the middle of that section of rock.
So it's a lot further at this end, near the house, you're further away from the wetlands. So he's, is that true?
Correct.
So you probably
correct.
Have your 35 foot distance.
You'll have your 35 here.
So as we're coming around the corner on that other picture, you do get closer, but he's always 25 feet away at least, and I think he's 28 feet away at his closest point.
Correct.
So what he's proposing, what he's asking is he'd like to have a retaining wall. He's highlighting the fact that it's eroding, and he wants to stop the erosion, he wants to put in a retaining wall, and what he's also proposing is any planting that you want, but on the wetland side of the retaining wall, he won't touch anymore.
Yeah.
He's not gonna do any work down there, no mowing. And it's going to be natural from here forward.
Well, that the erosion, I assume, is occurring.
Can I get to that?
Due to runoff from the driveway.
I would say a combination. Yeah, I would say that. But that's a seep-through driveway, so it's supposed to seep down and through. So there is some runoff, but it doesn't run off. It runs through.
Have you considered crushed stone or small riprap on that slope rather than a retaining wall?
I haven't considered that because I've put crushed stone here a couple times, and it's all just buckled down here.
Well, maybe some. I'm just suggesting
a
that you
grade,
consider
larger
stone,
yeah,
on that slope. Might be cheaper. It would prevent the erosion if you use the right size stone, and we wouldn't have a big retaining wall, so you'd still get infiltration.
Is the purpose of the retaining wall only for erosion, or
for safety as well? For safety as well. I see that you get this is again. I'm hoping we get to a point where you have a site visit where you can actually see how steep this really is. It's great. Again, that's a good suggestion about putting the bigger crushed stone. But I think it would be better served if we had the retaining wall along here and still having the filtration system through the retaining wall. So you could have, it could be built. The gentleman that I'm contracting to do the work has dealt with conservation with another group, so he couldn't make it here tonight, but he said I could absolutely explain what we're trying to do to continue filtration towards the wetlands. And as a caveat as well, here, I want to come close to the 25-foot buffer, I understand. In the front, and along with my whole property, there's a lot of areas where I don't, and I'd like to give back off of the buffer zone and not mow, you know, kind of to say, hey, I want to take a little here, but I want to give back. So we're still giving the same amount of conservation land to the town, but we're able to secure the driveway, the slope of the land,
As indicated in that picture, we commonly see problems with retaining walls. They crumble, they leak, and you're seeing it here.
That wall?
Yeah.
Again, when you see the site visit, that's not a real retaining wall.
Yeah, I mean, is this wall on the slope? Is it? Yeah,
that's not a poured wall.
It's not even in the ground.
There's no embedment to it, so it's moving with the slope.
You're going to put in a poured concrete retaining wall?
No. We're going to have it backed with crushed stone. I forget the exact schematic of it, but it's going to be crushed stone underneath, and it's going to have a rock face. So it's not going to be pure concrete.
Even if it's like a segmental block retaining wall, the wall would have to go below the slope a certain depth to make that stable. Whereas what I'm hearing from this is probably just a couple blocks
into the ground.
It's still on the slope. If the slope is failing, it's going to slide with it. So.
Yeah.
And that's why you're seeing why you're seeing the moving there.
Just speaking from all the problems we've seen with retaining walls, particularly on private land where.
Okay.
And if we put in another one, chances are the next Conservation Commission, the one after that, is going to be dealing with that crumbling retaining wall. I mean, look at the high school. They had to rebuild it 3 times.
The one for the parking lot?
The last one on our own nickel. Both last two. Because the contractor went out. Whereas the riprap isn't perfect, but it's easy to fix. Ask your builder about that. Just when you come in, if you and he are convinced that isn't a solution, putting riprap on that slope, explain to us why.
In the zone, within the 35-foot zone.
So
well, hopefully we can have the toe of that slope no closer than 35 feet. Maybe not. But.
So Jamie, I think he's highlighting a few things, but he also wants to gain that space next to the driveway. You
know,
to do that. well, to push him onto something else is he should just really just say, look, we want to ask you about the retaining wall.
Yeah.
The other stuff, if we don't get it, then we'd rather live with the grass because that's better than stone. Because they're looking at landscape too. But he's really at this point. I met with the family. I was out there. We walked the whole thing. It has gotten a little bit closer. Maybe not. Maybe it was just painted closer than what we talked about. But a lot of it seemed to be outside the 35-foot. So he can do it. He can do it in a lot of those spots. He just can't do it at the end. And what he's saying is he's not going to lose the area next to his walkway because that's not really even a good retaining wall. That thing doesn't work without it. It's likely to just keep moving. It's a maintenance nightmare.
Yeah, well, that
needs
will
to get
follow.
Fixed no matter what.
And that's outside the 35 foot.
I believe that's outside the 35-foot.
Yeah.
We're going to get out there and really take some measurements. We know where the 25-foot is. We can do the rest of it. But, I mean, I think he can do that. And it makes sense here with where this part is that something has to work. And it may work up into this third rail or whatever this thing is. But getting closer, then you're getting into the 20s.
Exactly. Yeah.
So that's where the commission has to understand that his desire is a retaining wall, and in those areas it probably fits within our regulations. Beyond that, it may not, and that's why he's trying to tell you that he won't mow out there, and he'll do some planting, and he'll, whatever, and he's concerned about his driveway.
In the walkway,
any of those things are going to fall in, but he's not an engineer.
Yeah, I think it's important to fix that portion, retain your walkway, and that wall, which appears to be less than ideal. I think that's probably important to do, but just as Chuck said, as you start to encroach on that 35 feet,
I do think there's room here for an additional. Because they're going to put the wall in and they're not going to mow down there, what's going to happen is we're going to have an additional buffer, outside. There's going to be an additional natural vegetation buffer because it'll grow up to the wall.
Yep, I won't be touching over that wall.
So there is benefit from that. Whereas now, you know, it's mowed to 25 foot, which is okay.
Yeah,
but,
no, I know. Yeah, I don't go in there.
Is this mowed once a week?
What?
Is this mowed regularly right now? Once a week, twice a week?
Right now, it's usually once every 7 to 10 days, yeah.
Oh, not really?
Yeah, it's...
Looks like a screw to the picture.
They mow with a helicopter? It is. It's, like I said, it's something that's... it's pictures don't do it justice, but again, like I said, I'm not trying to, you know, obviously I'm trying to gain the safety, the erosion of the driveway and make it a little longer, but as you can see that divot, when you get to that divot, that's about up to here when you put your foot in it. So it's kind of hard to see, but when you see the erosion, it's pretty substantial. And that happens to be, that's probably where the closest point is, would be to the 35 foot buffer. That would be probably around 29 feet.
His eye granite bound,
yeah.
Right here.
Yeah.
Right.
Is that at 25 feet?
That's 25 feet, so
mm-hmm.
I don't know, it's 10 feet. I don't know where 10 feet would be.
Well, if
you
go to that picture
that
with one of the tape measures, that's 6 feet, that's 29, 6 inches. The first, 28 feet, 9 inches is the first picture of that with the tape measure. So when you bring that out, it goes 28, 9, instead of 35.
So you want to put it at 28 feet?
Well, you know what, where she measured that and did that, it's still going to go in. It's still, from my liking, for the car, it's still too close in my eyes. It doesn't need to be that close to the end. It needs to just probably start closer to the 35. It should probably be starting right here, the wall. She has it, I think, right around here. In here, on the picture. It probably should just be starting here.
Do we, and maybe we don't have a plan right now.
This is for me to kind of just discuss.
Okay,
I have everything ready to go, but after having discussions with Chuck, I said, maybe let me come to the commission and talk to you guys and say, hey, do I do an RDA? Do I do a notice of intent? Or, you know, you guys can direct me and suggest what I should be doing.
Seems to me it would be a notice of intent.
If you're outside of the 35 feet, RDA is a possibility, but if you're inside, I agree, Anika. NOI is...
I think it's an NOI, you know. If we get, you know, obviously there's going to be wall outside of the 35, it's probably needed. So, I mean, if we see it on a plan with the NOI, what's inside, you know, we can have a little bit better discussion of what options are or what this looks like. But, you know, outside the 35, it looks like you're obviously doing, no matter what, you're doing stuff outside the 35 or wall outside the 35, so.
Oh, you mean like cutting and stuff?
Down
yeah,
in this
of
area,
course, yeah.
So.
But there's some areas, like I said, and I was mentioning to Chuck, is that like in the front and in the back, I'm surrounded by the conservation, so I don't cut to that on a lot of areas where there's a lot of square footage. So, you know, if you were to add it all up, it's kind of, you know, I don't know how it works, but I'm giving back. I want to take 5 feet here. I want to give back 10 feet. But, I don't know town politics or town committees. I don't know how that works, so I'm asking those questions. So I either do... you know, an art request for determination or a notice of intent.
So it sounds like the sense of the commission is notice of intent.
Mm.
You're having someone prepare it for you? An engineer or a wetland scientist or the contractor? Or?
The contractor would probably help me, but if you suggest I get an engineer in there, that's...
Well, part of what we require for work within the 35 foot is a variance, and it's outlined in the bylaw. And there are three... standards that are applied, and it's Chuck can provide you with that section of the bylaw if you can't find it.
Okay.
And you have to speak to those points when you submit to request the variance.
Yes. Okay.
So even if that's so, if you're in the 35.
So if there is an existing on the properties around me, if there's an existing wall that has already been put up that is well within, you know, under the 35 foot line, would that be an example to use in this discussion or not?
No, we need a site-specific.
No, yeah, I mean, but I'm saying, you know.
You're saying it's my neighbor has one.
Correct. No, I understand. Just asking that question because, you know, you see other walls that are very close. I'm just that's why I came here for get the feedback and tell me, you know, which way to go.
All the walls you see have already been approved under previous permits, previous notices of intent.
Okay.
So if you want to do additional work and put in your own wall,
mm-hmm.
that's your own notice of intent.
Yeah.
I understand what you're saying.
Yeah, I understand.
That's
you know,
just
for my step. Property. I get it. I'm
yeah.
not saying
yeah.
I can do what they did, but I'm just asking the question something that...
I understand
that,
the question,
okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
There's things that have gone in you know, years ago when bylaws were different or rules were different. And,
or,
and so,
yeah, or people didn't contact you.
We have something in our rules, I can't remember what it is, that limits the grade.
We do.
It's 3-1, isn't it?
Yeah. I think 3-1 sounds familiar.
Yeah, it's a little bit steeper than 3-1.
I think so.
I which got back to my question, I don't know if it was heard or not, but the certificate of compliance was already issued for this, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so that ship
has sailed. This is how it looked on the original plans.
This was a long time ago. We looked through the packet, and you know, Kristen and Sergi did this work. They were the engineers, and and as a matter of fact, there's no topo on the there's no topo on the certificate of compliance.
Phil Christensen plans. Was the engineer.
Christensen and Sergi.
Are they still around?
Yeah,
we are. Been around for a long time.
That's why I was asking if they're still around.
I worked with Phil McKiffin 35 years ago.
So.
He's an old guy. My age.
That's saying something.
So it sounds like you're looking for a notice of intent. We're going to need a site plan. We're going to need the exact spot where this wall is going and how far away from the wetland it is. And to go through the notice of intent process, which you can do yourself,
mm-hmm.
But we're going to ask for a variance if you're on those places that you're closer than 35 feet.
Okay.
And we will need a survey plan.
What's that?
Correct.
We will need a survey
plan. Started out with that.
But it could be isolated to the area he's working.
Oh,
right.
Sure.
Right.
It can be.
Yeah.
It doesn't have to be the entire.
Doesn't
property.
Have to be all right.
And you guys want to see what the wall looks like?
I think some wall schematic.
And
planning both above and at the level of the wall and below the wall, planning plan.
If you're gonna let the natural vegetation come in, fine.
Once, when and if you okay and we get everything going to the wall, you know, the other side will never be touched or.
And you can just note that on the
yep.
on the cross section.
Yep.
But if you know what kind of type of wall you're going to use, provide that as well.
Okay, yep.
The
gentleman actually sent me a schematic, but it didn't come across properly, and I tried to get it to you before I left to come here, but it didn't come, you didn't scan it well, so we garbage in, garbage out.
Do you guys remember that site, I think it was last summer, where the family wanted to clear some trees in the wetland? Some of them were dead, some of them were falling, and then there was that retaining wall back 2.5-3 feet. You remember that? It was right kind of next door to that property where the guy cut down the tree.
Oh, you mean, yeah, I do know what you're talking about. It's on, it's like Van Norton, and it's like 95 Van Norton. Is that the one? Or
remember his next door neighbor cut down a tree, and Chuck and the arborist got in a discussion.
Oh, wait a minute. That's a different one altogether. I thought we were talking about.
Anyway, the point being that retaining wall was crumbling right into the wetlands. And it was along their driveway and then back into their backyard. We just see it a lot. That's the most reason.
Part of the issue is if they're not the right style of the salt, if you salt your driveway,
correct.
It can be an issue.
The more
it
goes away.
Yeah.
No salt.
Even, you say you're going to let the vegetation grow up right next to it, a lot of times you say they want a certain buffer for roots.
Right.
Get away because roots will get in and
right.
start
destabilize
tearing.
It.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
All right.
Do you have any other questions?
Nope.
You know
some intent, and I'll work with getting that to you guys. Thank you very much. Appreciate your
Thank
time.
You.
All right. Now, minor projects.
This chair is way more comfortable.
Only the best for commission members. You should know that by now.
I just finally know.
Although they won't let us have pens. The selectmen have pens, but they won't let us have them
because
somebody
them
kept
back.
Stealing them. Exactly.
They're going to put chains on them.
Yeah, so I don't know if. So, Devidence Road, it was a minor project to take down and trim some trees. I went out there. One was. All of them, well, you know, trimming, first off, we're not really getting too involved in if it's less than 25% of the canopy. There was only one tree that was being taken down, and that was more than 50 feet away, so a minor project was issued for 65 Devidence Road. It was being done by, I think it was done by Polanski Tree Service. And Johanna Drive was Sonitude's outside of 50 feet on just redoing it back.
Okay.
Dividends check. Was that, is that that new construction on the corner that where the tree came down in the storm?
I don't know. It was Dividends?
Yeah.
Is that what you just said?
Yeah.
65 is almost at the end where the school is. So it's really...
Oh, that's the other one. Yeah, yeah. Okay, yep. I know where it is.
So those are the two Maya project permits. I issued an emergency permit at 217 Lowell Street.
Okay.
For a completely dead tree. The owner wanted to take it down himself, and he was going to cut it up for firewood, but it was 30 feet
sizable.
I called Bob Keating, and I said, I'm going to give a permit, and this guy's taking the tree down himself, and he goes, I've been there. Just can't tell him not to.
So it was on his property.
It was on his property, and he was just going to drop it and cut it up. So it was just some... it's been very dry anyways, so if he drops this thing, gets out there, cuts it up, and burns it for firewood, then it'll be fine. So it wasn't growing in the wetlands, it was on the bank, but it's definitely falling away from the house, of course. So I issued an emergency permit for that. It was, like I said, the reason why I did that is because it was completely dead, and it could have blown into the house in a windstorm. There was signs of cracking on the tree, so.
Well, while you're at it, how about 306 Main Street? Lease abatement measures?
Yeah, I put in an email, yeah. And it just seems like it's just a complicated project, and the owner needs to provide more and more information.
Well, I'm sorry, which project?
That's Pizza World.
It's not Pizza World.
So he's abandoned that because
no,
the
no, he's not
abandoned clear.
It. He's just kind of digesting the new plan because CPDC and Conservation wanted him to do this thing called RAM.
The RAM plan.
So he needed to like lay out what he was going to do just in case things happened, and LSP needed to provide that. And I don't think he had his LSP completely in place, and the town's going to require that whether he has his. Whether the thing is closed out or not. So he's looking at providing this, and I don't know what it was going to take, but he just said it makes him unsure about whether he can move forward, so he's unwilling to put money on the project, so he wants to see what happens if it gets closed out.
That site and the one at the Willow West Summer Ave intersection, they're staging areas for 10 projects. They're in resource areas, and there's no erosion control around them.
They fix that after you make
it. I know, and it looks better, but I think in the future, if the town's going to put a staging area in a resource area, there needs to be siltation control around it, because things go on in those staging areas that make a mess. I mean, I see people changing oil there, leaked hydraulic fluid, you name it.
What happens in a staging area stays.
Well, it doesn't. It gets
not if there's no erosion.
That's the problem.
But that's where we want to be. I agree. And Newport Construction, when we have a meeting every Thursday, we'll have one tomorrow, and all these things you mentioned, it's a really great way to run these town projects. They've been probably the best road crew I've ever worked with. So,
when you think about it, for a private project, we say no storing of equipment within the buffer zone, mm-hmm. yet the town is right there, 40 feet from the resource area, storing all this stuff with no control around it.
Is this still up? Speaking of that, draw a line. Right here, the town is looking, this is Salem Street, this is Cumberland Farms, this is a rotary out onto the highway. This has been a staging area for MassDOT before. The town wants to know, and they're going to get MassDOT permission, if they can also use it as a staging area for their projects.
Which project?
Any project that comes up. We're running out of staging areas.
They're redoing Salem.
They are.
They are?
It's all marked out now.
Yeah.
Are you talking about the area that they're using now for the highway projects? You're talking about inside the rotary?
Aren't they only working over right here? Yeah, inside the rotary. Yes, I am talking about that.
Right now, they're staged not there, but across the rotary from that.
They're in
the little triangle. See the little triangle up there?
Oh, right here?
Uh-oh.
No, up the other
near,
one.
There.
Near right
Camp
there.
Curtis Gill.
They're staged there, yeah. And to the right, too, as well.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Seems a little better.
So this is where George asked if...
That's a wetland, is it not?
Well, there's... You know,
what's that going through there?
Is it culverted? No, it's
no,
just
it's
a ditch.
Open.
That's the Saugus River right there.
Is it Saugus River there or right there? Is Walkersburg into the Saugus River?
Yeah.
So... He said, what does he need to do?
It's all vegetated right
but
now.
But MassDOT has been using this also, right? They're in this area.
It doesn't look open to me. I think it's all trees there.
See what it looks like.
It's a little bit open.
Yeah, I guess it is over there. I'm not paying attention when I go through there, apparently.
It
looks like there's a spot right here.
I'm paying attention to people not using their signal is what I'm doing.
I don't know how that would work, and they certainly need permission from MassDOT, but
they might need permission from Wakefield also.
No, well, that's the line right there. So, maybe not. But it did come up, and I asked George if he was willing to put in Jersey barriers to keep them from encroaching after we set an area.
That makes sense.
And then they wouldn't go any further. He said he would be willing to do that.
Good area.
It's
a large, you know, it's a large enough area that you could get. You could.
It's still in the buffer zone, though.
Oh yeah, it's 200 feet from there.
And we generally don't allow that in the buffer zone, particularly in a river area.
So what are the alternatives? Like where else could they? Where
no,
else?
No, he had
no
other spots. He just said, "What do you think of that?" I said, "Well."
How about on that spot right there? Is that far? Is that far enough away, or is the river going underneath there? Nope, to the left.
To here.
No, I'm sorry, the other way.
This left.
Right there.
Your other left.
My left. Okay.
Is the river right there?
Oh, yeah, my left. That's what I meant. You're right.
Yeah.
Sorry.
That's the river,
that
right?
That line is the town line.
Yeah, this is
in
the town line
places,
that kind of follows the river right there.
The river,
see the river.
Sometimes it's not.
Can you zoom in?
No, that's the extent. Of
actually, there. That's a canal there.
I thought it was a canal in back of only down.
Only on one side of the bank.
Behind the property. Behind a certain preschool.
School.
Yeah.
Goddard School.
Yeah.
Here's the that's the river.
But it's culverted underneath that infield there.
Well, it goes behind the Cumberland Farms.
But I mean, where it bends right there, it's culverted. It goes underneath the...
Right, under the...
The whole red line is culverted in between the rotary?
I think it's open in the rotary, but
it's
when it goes under the...
It looks open right there, somewhat.
It's open between that.
Yeah, it's only culverted culverted
between
underneath the road. And then that's Track Road right there, and that's all open. It goes right to the backside of Home Depot.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
So, anyways, yeah, I guess just think about it.
Okay.
It's just a very template for our permits. We don't allow storage equipment in the buffer zone. We shouldn't treat the town differently than we do a private commercial development.
See how far it is. So we're doing 200 feet, or we're doing 100?
Well, we'll see how far it is. Then
it's temporary. We could go. We could go 100.
That's 105.
Yeah, it might be inside the 100.
Yeah. Yeah. There's a lot of room there outside the 100. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, if he's not going to be cutting down any vegetation, if he put up an erosion control and four-inch construction fence, so it's out of 100, it's not a bad area. He can worry about access off the...
It's a good size area, yeah.
You know that huge project they're doing up there on 93 in Methuen, just across the Merrimack River? That is a huge circle there with a lot of traffic. They have their staging area on the inside, and it works, but they had to figure out how to get them in and out. It had to be a separate entrance and entrance. You can't have them both in the same place.
Right, right.
So it can work.
Third of an acre, half an acre.
That's what we get, half an acre.
It's bigger than that other area.
How often do you make a residential or commercial applicant put up Jersey barriers?
Rarely, if ever.
Really?
So we're I think it's the our own community, and if he's willing to put up Jersey barriers and he can get anywhere near that 100,
yeah,
I think that would be workable.
And there's no catch bases in there, so it's not like, you know.
You just got to understand that this, he's not asking for one project. This is going to be the go-to spot. So it's like...
What, open-ended?
Yeah.
Well, no, he'd have to give us permission. It would almost be like we'd have to write a permit and then put in conditions like notify us when you're not there. We want you to amend the soil, whatever we could think of that would...
Well, that's just reason to never leave.
Exactly.
But it's just for Salem Street.
And then
I thought, I was thinking it was just to redo Salem and then gives it up.
So if we allow him there and we have to do some mitigation for this disturbance?
Well, yeah, if it's going to become a perpetual...
Yeah.
No, well, let's not let that happen. Let's just stipulate that it's for the
temporary
accessing Salem Street to get that project
temporary
done.
Temporary road work.
And after that, he's going to restore it.
Yes.
Take the Jersey barriers out and
have it for a specific project.
Yeah.
It doesn't have to be open.
Who owns that land, MassDOT?
I don't know. It's not going to come up, I bet. But
It should. Oh, you're saying that ownership?
We're running into the same issues as Willow Street. We're giving people permission to do stuff on land we don't own.
Do you think it's town? Do you think it's the part of the highway? Right,
I think it's part of the interchange.
I can't imagine MassDOT putting in a rotary and not
having
the
title to that. Yeah, it's probably part of the entire
interchange.
Someone
build a Marriott
or a car dealership. Oh no, that's a mover.
Houses are looking.
All right, so that's that.
Yeah. Okay. So while we're talking about site visits. I was thinking about a site visit anyway. We need to move the site visits to Sunday.
Okay.
Because we barely got done we had three site visits on.
Chuck was talking about maybe moving it to 4:30.
On Monday.
What I said was a lot of people don't go to the site visits anymore.
That wouldn't bother me if I don't go.
Available, and Becky always goes, and if you guys move them,
I know Becky has a hard time with Sundays, she told us.
If you guys said 4:30 or something during my time, I could always go, and that would be great. I'd love it.
I'm all for that.
But I'm just suggesting it, only because that I know that a lot of times it's one person going.
I mean, you can't go.
Well, to be honest, 4:30, it's easier for me to get out at 4:30 on a Monday than guaranteeing I'll be home on Sunday at 4:30.
But I mean, come February 4:30.
Even earlier on Sunday. Yeah, I mean, if I'm even midday when you start to get to an earlier.
Well,
time.
I could also, I'm 8 to 5:30.
One thing to think about is that we are short one member now, and there's one or two of us coming up for renewal in June, so we're going to be looking for more members, and if we have it at 4:30. That's going to exclude most people that have a normal 40-hour week job and turn them off from being the commission. That's why historically we moved to Sunday morning so it would not interfere with work hours.
Well, and I think it should be open. If it works, if whatever time works best for the committee is what we should choose. And if
right.
there's people coming on that
think there's a better time, or then I think that's worth considering again.
But
we should try to select something where most people can.
It might scare them off. That's what I'm thinking. They would never apply if they say, "Oh, I did 4:30. I haven't worked."
How often are we doing site visits right now?
Every other week.
This commission, unlike most commissions, goes out to every project. So.
Every 2 weeks.
Right.
Every week.
There's a site visit.
Every week.
Every other week.
Yeah.
Typically, what I've seen is when there's an issue, which of course extends the permitting process, then they go out.
So, how does anybody feel about that, changing our policy?
That's Boxford's policy in Reading and Arlington.
Now that we have a full-time agent, that makes a difference, certainly. Does anybody feel like we want to maybe decide that, hey, we don't want to go to all these site visits unless it's necessary?
I don't know. I always thought
we get a lot of good information from them when you actually get out there, and a lot of times you hear something that they probably would have told you when they're standing right there, or
I have to say
something that.
I think it's great that you go out there because then everyone knows what's going on.
Yeah.
I mean, it's like, it's the difference between reading the book and then, you know.
What we have done, and it works more often than not, if we have 12 site visits on a Monday night or a Sunday morning and everybody shows up, we'll divide in half. And half will go to one set and the other half to the other. And that generally works. But as a standard practice, I think it's important to see the site.
Right. I mean, I think it's important too, and I think that it makes sense. The only thing I'm saying is that a lot of people aren't going, and the people that are going could do it on Monday. And let's not pretend that just to keep it at 7 o'clock, it makes it one big difference. We'll probably go to more and have more people going at 4 o'clock, and right now that seems to work. Better, at least I'm hearing it seems to work better. I'm not sure.
I could actually probably make 4 o'clock on a Monday better.
And it could be any time. It could be 3 o'clock.
4:30 is going to be dark.
But it's going to be dark.
Well, not that long.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I know. Well, why don't we move it to 4 o'clock or 4:30 just for now?
You could keep
and then
it on
as,
Sunday.
And then as the time,
oh, yeah, that's
as
right.
The daylight hours shrink.
Well, we got another 6 or 8 weeks.
Let's take a straw poll. We're all here, right? All members are here. Six, yeah. Can we take a straw poll Monday, 4 o'clock versus Sunday at 9 o'clock?
I mean, I have to say maybe.
Monday. So who?
Monday.
Monday at 4 o'clock.
Monday
I'm for
4
that.
O'clock.
For now, anyway. Until
well, voting for it or can make it?
This is
straw poll.
This is straw poll. This is
a straw poll.
If you had to choose from,
if you had to choose.
If I had to choose.
Yeah.
If I had to choose. If the stars aligned and I was able to, I'd rather do Monday.
I would like to go. That's my thing. I'd like to.
You can or you can or can't go on Mondays. You can go on Mondays.
Even if you change it in the future.
Whatever worked.
Right now, you can go on Mondays, right, John?
I can go anytime between 8 and 5:30. Well, Monday, I can't go in. 9 o'clock. We have public hours. 9 o'clock. I could leave. So
let's do that.
Do Monday 4:30 for a few, two or three site visits and see how it works.
That sounds good to me.
I'm available either day. There's no on Sunday site visits. Is there any sort of code or regulation against being hungover on a site visit?
Not at all.
Because it is Saturday night.
Yeah, you don't get to drive.
Yeah.
It's site visits at your own risk.
Don't let me drive on
That's
Sunday
good.
Mornings.
Yeah.
So it sounds like Monday at
One issue I have starting next month, the month after, I teach on Monday nights. So I could not go on site visits on Monday starting in January.
Well, is there a reason why you couldn't go on the site visit on your own on Sunday morning?
There's two constraints. One is that we have to notify the property owner that there are going to be people coming at two different
times,
which is not insurmountable. And the other is the interaction among the people at the site visit is just as important as seeing it, in my opinion.
Yeah.
So that's, I could never make a Sunday site visit starting the first
Monday.
A Monday site visit
Which
starting the first of the year.
We might change by then. We might have to change because of the daylight.
Yeah.
Right.
So,
right.
But
right now it's not an issue. So it sounds like Monday at 4:30 is when we'll do it.
Yep.
Right now. Okay.
For the next one. We can decide after that.
Yeah.
Until the next one.
A week.
So, does anybody have anything else to bring before the commission?
Was there monies that are supposed to be approved? What's on the bottom?
Oh, bills
approved.
That's just a placeholder.
Bills approved.
Next to it. Then
minutes.
I don't have a check coming. Well,
what about the no hunting signs? Where'd we end up?
No hunting signs are up.
Are they at eye level?
How are they up? Are they attached to a tree? They're a stick?
They're attached to a tree. What are those hex-headed bolts or screws?
Flags.
Flags. They use those. They must lock in there, but that's what they used. And they're...
Who's they? DPW?
DPW. 7 to 8 feet up high.
Oh, good.
I had a picture. I'm not going to bother showing because it takes too long, but... I have a picture of Ivy Road where they're doing that bypass for the water, and you know, it wasn't more than 8 feet, and it's probably 7.5. Maybe the top of the sign was 8 feet, but it wasn't at eye level. Okay,
good.
They're all up. People are noticing them because some of the inspectors came in and telling, you know, making fun and stuff like that. And saying stuff, but
well,
yeah,
inspectors,
good.
What kind of inspectors?
Like building and plumbing and electrical. The people that are out around town, you know, saying that they noticed them. So, but that's a good point. Ivy has started. They've cleared that out. They're
the Belmont Ivy connection.
Belmont,
yeah.
Ivy connection.
We ought to have that on site visit list.
Okay, it'll be on the next one, but it's going to be done by this Friday.
Well,
they started,
I like those
good,
projects.
Good,
they started
help.
Monday.
I like those projects, yeah.
So it's not.
That's the way to do it.
They have a big contract for the town, and they've come in and done one thing and left. They come in and the second thing comes. This is the first time I've gone there where it's cleared and the trees are down, and they actually have their water line and fused together and ready to go. There was a couple of issues which I had to talk to Ryan about. I was talking to the contractor, he thought he was driving through the stream, and I told him he wasn't. You know, he thought that, you know, we're going right down, straight down the other way. I told him he's going around, he's going to dig from both sides, and I told Ryan that.
Oh, he's going to drive the excavator through the stream?
It's there's no water in it.
Right.
And you know how these guys.
Yeah.
I don't want to make fun of anyone. Anyways, that seemed logical, and I just told them, no, we're not going to have that happen. And the other thing is they're really compacting the soil, so I'm going to have them rake it a little bit with a bucket on the way out, and they're going to cast some wetland soil mix, like seed mix out.
It'll
there
work
on the way,
yeah,
back.
Yeah.
Put the rocks there, and that's it. I don't think there's anything else that we're going to be dealing with, but they can't go through that stream.
Yep. Okay. So
it's they 30 feet wide now. It's, you go down there, you're gonna be amazed. Wow, what do we do?
Yeah.
So we have the minutes for approval. We sent draft minutes.
They're gonna do trenchless construction.
7/22/2015 and 8/26/2015. Any comments on the minutes? I'll start with July 22nd.
Did everyone have a chance to go through them?
I went through 7/22.
Okay.
Just a little correction on the members present. Little typo. My name has two N's.
Oh, sorry.
That's all right. And on the second page...
There's two corrections there, because I think I noticed this on the same one. Flynn, not Lynch.
Oh, Flynn. Yeah. Yeah.
F-L-Y-N-N. Yeah.
Okay.
Flynn.
Might as well get it straight.
Lynch. Oh, sorry.
That's
okay. I don't know who that is, but... Oh, God.
Will Flynn? Is that typo?
Yeah, Flynn.
No, Lynch. Lynch was the Fidelity guy, wasn't he? Was it Michael Lynch? Wasn't Michael Lynch?
Michael Lynch, no.
Peter Lynch, yeah.
So, and then on page 2, under administrators' reports, street acceptances, there weren't any notes to three of the streets, Hanscom, Bethune, and Dividends. And I don't know if anything needs to be said there or not. I just
Bethune needs a tree, or it's not going to be accepted. So
needs a tree.
I gotta get to the developer and ask him.
Did
Plus
we
it's
actually
still underneath our order of conditions?
Did we actually talk about those at the meeting, though? Or
no, they're not coming up.
I don't remember.
We have accepted streets already.
I think that was just
and
the list.
They've already
oh,
gone
okay,
to, the,
okay.
to the selectmen. For fall town meeting, you were provided
oh,
that list. Those are
right.
done. The ones
right.
you just mentioned, Dividends.
Hanscom, Bethune, and Dividends.
Bethune is not on this list.
Okay.
I don't think Dividends is either. In Hanscom.
But the question is, were they discussed at the meeting?
I think they were.
Yeah.
They must have been discussed.
I think they were. I just
They're
don't know
list.
If
what did
we
say
should,
about it?
Well, that's the thing. It's blank.
I think they were on the list, and then I don't. Well, I could be wrong. I thought there were a few streets that we just
We didn't talk about
a discussion on. Yeah,
I can go back and confirm whether there were no issues or not
with those three. I just saw the blank next to them, and I mean, not even no issues. Put next
Maybe
to
I was
it.
Just reading the list of streets that are on it, not that the ones that were accepted. I'm
okay.
not sure.
It's been a while. But that was all I had.
Okay. Any other comments? Okay, I'll entertain a motion to accept the minutes.
Which day?
July 22nd.
So moved.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
All those in favor? Okay, 8:26.
No
that
comments.
Was sent separately, correct? Yes.
I didn't see that. When was that?
Yeah,
sent?
I don't know that
I
got that one.
That was sent on September 22nd.
Right.
Yeah, it was sent separately.
Yes, yesterday. That's why I'm seeing it.
I just ordered cheese today, Chuck. I forgot that swamp maple. I just texted him and told him to order it.
See that?
Thank you. Well, I think, it's another benefit here going on.
So
I have no comments.
No comments?
Nope.
Okay. So is there a motion to accept the minutes from the 26th?
I make a motion to accept the minutes from the 26th.
Second.
All those in favor? Okay. That's it. Anything
Move
else?
We adjourn.
Second.
I don't have anything.
Okay.
Else.
That's it. We're out of here.
Close.
I thought this would be longer.